Good morning. Thank you for joining us for the second day of what has been a really invigorating conference. My name is Lindsay Buten, and I'm a grad student at Annenberg, and I'm really excited to be moderating the panel Law Through the Lens. This morning's panelists will be discussing how visual technology and images get used as legal evidence, and debating which policies and procedures would strengthen its potential while safeguarding subjects who are surveilled. And importantly, our panel this morning will be attentive to the tensions between ethical standards in film editing and image making, and the sometimes competing pressure to tell persuasive stories with images. So we'll hear first from Lawrence Douglas, who is the James A. Grossfeld Professor of Law, Jurisprudence, and Social Thought at Amherst College in Massachusetts. We'll next hear from Nenad Golchevsky, who is the head of the Outreach Office of the International Criminal Tribunal for the former Yugoslavia in The Hague, the Netherlands. Then we'll hear from Keith Hyatt, who is the director of the Technology Program at the Human Rights Center at UC Berkeley School of Law, and who was the 2015 winner of the MacArthur Award for Creative and Effective Institutions. And finally, we'll hear from Rebecca Wexler, who's a filmmaker, a fellow of the Information Society Project, and co-founder and director of the Visual Law Project at Yale Law School, where she's currently also a JD candidate. So please give our panelists a warm welcome.
So good morning, and thanks for having me here. Does everyone have access to, where do these images appear? Is it just, it's on the monitors as well, yeah? Okay, great. So what is this a picture of? Maybe if we had more time, I might ask each of you to construct an account of what you think is pictured. I think we could probably agree that this appears to be a record of extreme medical distress. That is, perhaps a bombing victim is being rushed from the scene of a terror attack, or maybe the victim of a school shooting is being bundled away to an awaiting ambulance. On closer inspection, though, certain anomalies might strike our eye. On the left, we see a cluster of photographers. So if this is a sudden medical emergency, it's one in which a concentration of media was already on hand. And then we notice the six uniformed officials, presumably police, offering no assistance, but standing guard, though to what end? And then there are these four EMTs, one with his back to us, with the words judicial paramedic in German emblazoned on the back of his day glow jacket. So maybe we can refine our surmise. Maybe a judge or a lawyer has been assassinated or viciously attacked in court and is now being rushed to the hospital. In fact, this photo documents a very different kind of event. It was taken in the trial of John Demjanjuk that began in Munich in November 2009. Demjanjuk stood accused as an accessory to the murder of 28,000 Jews during his tenure in 1943 as a guard at the Sobibor death camp. And the stretcher did not carry one of Sobibor's few remaining Jewish survivors. Rather, the stretcher carried the defendant himself. This is a photo of Demjanjuk's entrance into the court to stand trial. I begin with this picture because it powerfully reminds us, I think, that spectacular trials involving mass atrocities inevitably involve more than a colloquy over evidence and law. They also stage a competition over images that will be transmitted and circulated around the world. The photo of Demjanjuk's court entrance cannot then be seen as documentary in any kind of simple sense, but rather Demjanjuk's entrance had been very carefully orchestrated by the defense in order to produce images that would serve as a principal weapon in its attack on the legitimacy of the proceeding. Now, in the time that I have available this morning, I can't describe in detail Demjanjuk's bizarre legal odyssey, an odyssey that gave rise to the lengthiest and probably most convoluted criminal proceeding to arise out of the Holocaust, though I do detail it in full in my new book, The Right Wrong Man, right here, that was published this past Wednesday and is priced to move. But for now, it suffices to say that the Ukrainian-born Demjanjuk, then known as Ivan, served in the Soviet Red Army. He was taken as a prisoner of war by the Germans in the spring of 1942, and then he became a collaborator. And after the war, Demjanjuk managed to enter the United States, where he lived for decades. In the late 80s, he was extradited from the United States to Israel, where he was tried, convicted, and sentenced to death as the former Treblinka guard known as Ivan the Terrible. And this Demjanjuk trial, this Ivan the Terrible trial that took place in Jerusalem, has gone down in the annals of legal histories as one of the most famous cases of mistaken identity. Because on appeals, new evidence showed that Ivan the Terrible had actually been another Ukrainian altogether. And the conviction was ultimately tossed out. And yet the evidence wasn't entirely exculpatory either. That is, if it proved that Demjanjuk had not been Treblinka's Ivan the Terrible, it appeared that he nevertheless was Ivan the Not-So-Hot. That is, that he had served as a guard only at a different death camp, in fact, Sobibor. So years of legal struggle followed until ultimately Demjanjuk found himself deported to Germany, where in November 2009, the now 89-year-old defendant was, as we've seen, carried into the courtroom on a stretcher to stand trial as an accessory to the murder of 28,000 persons. Now, the image of the prostrate defendant was meant, however, to show more than simply that Demjanjuk was a very old man at the start of his trial. Rather, it sought to represent the defendant as himself a victim, indeed as a victim of judicial violence. Throughout the trial, which did actually result in a Demjanjuk's conviction, his defense lawyer nevertheless insisted that his client was no more than a scapegoat. And the defense insisted that the German legal system was now belatedly trying to make good on its pathetic record of dealing with big fish Nazis by now trying this old man, this decrepit little minnow. And in this argument, Demjanjuk was represented as a victim of Justizmord, that is, judicial murder, that he's been hounded for decades, first by Americans, then by Israelis, and now by German legal systems. And it was a legal argument that found its most powerful display in the representation of the stretcher-bound Demjanjuk. The visuals of Demjanjuk were then essential to the defense's attempt to challenge the very legitimacy of the trial. Now, however tendentious this particular effort may have been, the tactical deployment of images, I believe, has been a feature of all spectacular atrocity trials. So if we go back, for example, to Nuremberg, prosecutors there sought to answer the defense's accusation of Victor's justice by structuring their case around visual documentary evidence rather than on the testimony of eyewitnesses. Prosecutors worried that Nazi crimes were so extreme that survivor testimony would be dismissed as exaggerated or perhaps even fabricated. And so as a result, they basically privileged the visual over the voice of witnesses. And this privileging of the visual and documentary brought extraordinary forms of evidence before the Nuremberg Tribunal. Prosecutors dramatically screamed documentary footage that chronicled the liberation of Western concentration camps, and this, in fact, represented an unprecedented use of documentary film and atrocity footage in a criminal trial. And this is an image taken of the courtroom at Nuremberg. And the thing I think is extraordinary about this is just in the background you see a movie screen. And this is the screen on which was projected this documentary footage. And here is a still from this footage, kind of this very, very dramatic footage of the liberation of concentration camps. Prosecutors also displayed grotesque artifacts intended to make vivid the depraved nature of Nazi criminality. And here's a very famous image of an American associate prosecutor named Thomas Dodd, father of the future U.S. Senate Christopher Dodd, who was holding this shrunken head of a Polish prison of war that had been prepared at the Buchenwald concentration camp. Now, these spectacular visuals were not simply meant to offer irrefutable evidence of astounding atrocities. As the photo of Demjanjuk's entrance into the court reminds us, these visuals never simply speak for themselves, but always must be spoken for. Indeed, such visuals do not document as much as they represent, and as representations, as figurations, they are images whose meaning has to be constructed and crafted, and whose meaning thus remains available to contestation and debate. The Jerusalem trial of Adolf Eichmann in 1961 reversed Nuremberg's representational logic. The Eichmann trial very consciously privileged voice over visual. The prosecutors believed that orienting the trial around the testimony of survivor witnesses would, they believe, better capture the imagination of a world audience, that is, by telling Holocaust history through the lived memory and stories of survivor witnesses. And again, this decision was not simply a sober judicial calculation of which form of evidence could best prove the legal guilt of the accused. Rather, the decision to privilege the voice, again, reflected the belief that survivors' stories could most powerfully convey the importance and the meaning of the trial to a larger audience that is both domestically in Israel and internationally as well. So here's actually an image taken. It's kind of interesting to observe that some of the most famous images associated with the Eichmann trial are not images of evidence that was presented, but it's images of the spectators at the trial reacting to the narratives they heard on the part of the witnesses. And in this way, the witnesses created witnesses to themselves. That is, the spectators, in a sense, became witnesses of the witnesses who were testifying. And this brings us back to the Demjanjuk Munich trial. It's been observed that the Holocaust is on the cusp of passing from memory into history, and certainly this trial in Munich made clear just how close we are to that moment. Indeed, the Munich trial was largely a trial by history. That is, there were no survivor witnesses alive to identify Demjanjuk. Indeed, the principal witnesses were professional historians and forensic experts who offered testimony that very often sounded like a rather detailed lecture that one would hear in an advanced history seminar. They showed photos of the Sobibor death camp, which in 1944 had been plowed under and forested over by the SS. And today, Sobibor looks at once more like a crime scene and an archaeological dig than any kind of a place that one would associate with relatively recent history. Now, for the prosecution, the passing of the generation of the perpetrators made the need to try Demjanjuk now all the more urgent. For the defense, though, the defense tried to insist, in fact, that that moment had already passed. That is, that the Holocaust already had gone from memory into history. And the images of the moribund defendant were deployed very much to create the impression that the accused was himself no more than an exhumed corpse. That is, perhaps one of the relics that had been unearthed in the Sobibor archaeological digs. So let's return very briefly to that first day of the trial and the defendant's entrance into the courtroom on a stretcher. And again, this is kind of from a little bit, this picture captures the vantage point that I saw when I was in the courtroom at the time. And it seemed again that it was not that the defendant was old or feeble or otherwise ill. Rather, it simply seemed to all observers that the defendant was dead, that a corpse was being brought in to stand trial. And this spectacular entrance promptly triggered the trial's very first heated debate. And the debate was not about evidence, it was not about the indictment, but it was about the presentation of the accused. So a lawyer representing relatives of people murdered at Sobibor, he jumped to his feet and he gestured to the gurney and he said, well, why is he positioned like this? And it was reported that the defendant, who had yet to show any signs of life, had said that he was uncomfortable sitting up. Well, then would it be possible, the lawyer asked, at least to raise him? A doctor conferred with the defendant, who, it was reported, rejected this suggestion. So the trial, just minutes old, was now promptly recessed so that the judges could weigh the matter. Soon a Solomonic compromise was reached. The defendant could remain on the gurney, but now would be propped up at a 45-degree angle. Now, it may seem odd, even grotesque, to have lawyers debating over the angle of repose for a defendant charged with complicity in mass atrocities. But as I've tried to suggest, however briefly this morning, such debates are in fact inevitable in these spectacular atrocity trials, because these trials inevitably enact a struggle over more than proof and evidence in a conventional juridical sense. The struggle over visuals invariably becomes a struggle over the representations that will define the public meaning of such proceedings. So it's perhaps unsurprising that an answer to the defense images came in the form of rival photos that had been secretly taken of Demjanjuk by undercover agents of the U.S. Immigration and Customs Enforcement Agency on the eve of his departure to Munich. And these images, one of which we see here, powerfully argued that the man on trial was someone other than Ivan the Corpse. So thank you very much.
Good morning, everyone. I couldn't imagine a better segue for what I'm about to talk about. Thank you for that. I will be speaking about one particular aspect of the outreach program of the International Criminal Tribunal for the former Yugoslavia. And I would like to start by showing you a photograph, which some of you might have seen before. If you can have it on the screen. Here we go. Now we have it. So this was a photograph heard around the world. It was taken by two British journalists the summer of 1992 in Prijedor in western Bosnia, in a place which at the time Bosnian Muslims and Croats considered to be a concentration camp, while the local Serbs claimed that it was simply a transitional refugee camp. After the photograph was published and after more details surfaced, it became obvious to the entire world that these were in fact concentration camps, places of torture, suffering, and death. Nevertheless, when I was driving around with some friends, maybe 6 years ago, around Prijedor, and we wanted to visit one of these former camps, which actually was a deserted mine at the time, we couldn't find our way, so we stopped and asked a couple of people, passers-by, and each one of them would say, camps? Which camps? We didn't have such camps. We don't know about such camps. So even 15 years after the conflict ended, people were not ready to face the ugly truth of the horrors that have been committed in their name and under their flag. It remains similar until this day. And in the meantime, in fact, very soon after this photograph was published, and partly as a result of that, the United Nations Security Council established the International Criminal Tribunal for the former Yugoslavia with a mandate to bring to justice those most responsible for serious violations of humanitarian law in the territory of the former Yugoslavia in the 1990s. And in that way, to contribute to building and maintenance of sustainable peace in the region. Over the last 20 years since it was established, the ICTY had huge judicial success. It indicted 161 persons, and all of them were brought to justice in one way or another. The tribunal has addressed crimes committed in dozens of municipalities around former Yugoslavia, throughout former Yugoslavia. And to give some context, I would like to show you a map of those areas. can have it on the screen, yeah. And that maybe provides context where the region is and geographically. However, this judicial success was not enough for the tribunal to fully realize its mandate. If it was truly to contribute to the maintenance of sustainable peace in the region, its work and judgments needed to resonate far beyond its courtrooms. It was not enough for justice to be done. It needed to be seen to have been done. And more, it was important that people in the former Yugoslavia know and accept the facts established by the tribunal to reduce the chances of such horrors ever happening again. However, the ICTY was, and unfortunately still is, negatively perceived in larger parts of the region. And what's more, people in the former Yugoslavia mostly don't know basic facts about its work. There are many reasons for that, but unfortunately I don't have time to go into that. So some 6 or 7 years after the establishment of the tribunal, it became clear that there's a need to communicate better the work of the tribunal to the people most affected by it, and that's the people in the former Yugoslavia. And thus, the outreach program was established. And that was its main goal, to go to the region, to explain what the court works to the people of the region in their own language through a variety of means. So over the years in the outreach program, we developed various tools to communicate the events that happened in the courtrooms and that were happening in the courtrooms. That included community outreach, media outreach, work with young people, capacity building, use of internet, of social media, and finally, multimedia production. So some 5 years ago, at the end of 2010, we decided to start producing our own in-house documentary films. And there were several reasons for that. The goal was to create an efficient mean of communication which would communicate the work of the tribunal and to make it meaningful and comprehensible to the widest audience possible in the former Yugoslavia, but also beyond. Trials before the tribunal last for years. They involve hundreds of witnesses. They involve thousands of pieces of evidence. The judgments are written on anything between 1,000 or 2,000 pages of a thick legal discourse. So apart from the people who professionally follow the ICTY, nobody really reads those judgments. And no one can follow the entire course of a trial. So we wanted to create a product which would be easily and quickly consumable, which could educate people, tackle misinformation and denial, and help disseminate the stories of victims and survivors heard in our courtrooms. We also hope that these documentaries will be used by the actors in the former Yugoslavia to facilitate the processes of transitional justice and facing the past. This was very exciting, and the possibilities at that time seemed limitless. Over the 20 years of its existence, the tribunal has accumulated millions of pages of documents which went into evidence. It includes tens of thousands of hours of audiovisual recordings, thousands of artifacts and photographs. And what's more, we were in a unique position to have access to the most important actors of these trials, to prosecutors, judges, investigators, and of course, to victims and witnesses. But this was a precedent. Never before has an international tribunal created or produced a documentary about its own work. In general, courts are not really inclined to tell stories about their trials and their judgments. As lawyers like to say, judgments speak for themselves, except they don't. So when we started it, one simple question arose: how do we do this? As we began producing our first documentary, we realized that the endless possibilities we departed from will soon meet numerous challenges and obstacles. The first question we needed to resolve was where to start. And then, which of the dozens or hundreds of possible topics do we choose? Which crimes do we select? Which stories do we tell? How do we select the witnesses? So we decided to begin from something that seemed unquestionable, namely the ICTY's groundbreaking work in prosecuting wartime crimes of sexual violence. That was our first documentary. Another key conceptual question was how to shape these films, which form they should have, how to present the trials and judgments, testimonies and findings of the court without, without plainly repeating the arguments heard in the courtrooms and ending up creating basically a summarized trial in pictures. Then we needed to decide who should speak in the films, who should be telling the stories and how. Obviously, we wanted to have the main actors explain the issues at hand. We wanted prosecutors, judges, investigators, victims to speak. However, it turned out it's not as easy as it seemed. First, the judges declined to speak for our documentaries because they are bound not to speak about any individual cases they have sit in the chamber of. Then, very early on, we decided that even though recordings of all testimonies in the court are public and available for anyone to use them without any additional concerns, we decided that it would be ethical from our side to contact the witnesses and ask them for their agreement for us to use their testimonies. And unfortunately, many of them decided to decline to give us consent to use their testimonies. Further, the imperative of this project was that we have to preserve full impartiality of the tribunal. The claims made in the films had to be 100% supported by the findings contained in the judgments, and there could be almost no opinions, interpretations, or presumptions included in the film. So anything that was said by our interviewees, all excerpts of trial session recordings, each testimony, every visual we use, needed to be supported by the judgments and could not be even perceived as one-sided. It is very difficult to tell a story in that way, when even banal or contextual information had to be rooted and supported by the judgment. Also, in producing these films, we had to negotiate a virtual minefield of very different interests and expectations between the chambers, the registry, office of the prosecutor, defense lawyers, and most importantly, victims and witnesses. Legitimate concerns of all these sides needed to be reconciled and then put together in one coherent story. Again, these are just some of conceptual issues we had to address, and there were many others which we dealt with, which included the selection of material, forms of storytelling, inclusion of voiceovers and graphics in the films, use of information which were collected externally, and inclusion of interviewees outside of the tribunal. Then there were also many practical challenges, which I won't go into at this particular point. So finally, we had to figure out what is the best way to disseminate these products, these films. We opted for a multi-channel approach in dissemination, so we organized premieres and screenings throughout the region of the former Yugoslavia, but we also produced DVD copies of the documentaries, which we then give away on all of our activities and events. We also worked with TV networks and TV stations in the former Yugoslavia to broadcast the documentaries, free of charge, of course, but we needed to persuade them to do it. And we also make our films available online, so they're available on our YouTube channel, and we promote them through our website and through our Facebook and Twitter profiles. So I think I still have time to show you a short trailer from our latest documentary, which was premiered last year. It deals with the crimes committed in Central Bosnia and cases related to that. I hope that this short excerpt will actually illustrate some of the dilemmas that we had to deal with and how we resolved them.
For the people of Stupni Do, the 23rd of October, 1993 was hell. There is simply no other way to describe it. On that day, the village of Stupni Do became a blazing inferno of death and destruction. The sounds of gunfire and shelling of explosions were later replaced by the sounds of women and children, and indeed, I am sure, grown men crying.
That's what's really heartbreaking about Central Bosnia. I mean, the whole war everywhere in Bosnia and everywhere in the former Yugoslavia was unnecessary and could have been avoided, but nowhere more than Central Bosnia.
I can't remember the sequence, but we went into house after house. And the scene in each house was that we discovered dead people, sometimes one, sometimes two, sometimes in the front room. These are small houses. On a sofa, on the floor.
Kad smo došli tu kod ubijenog mi brata, on je naredio ovaj visoki vojnik, naredio je ocu iskorači dva koraka. Otac je to jedva učinio I onda mu je sa metra opalio ovaj jedan metak direktno u sljepočnicu. Otac je pao odmah na licu mjesta je mrtav, ja mislim, ostao. Zatim je meni rekao, iskoraci dva koraka. Ja sam ga poslušao, iskoracio sam. Sa lijeve strane mi je isto meni sa metra opalio metak. Metak mi je evo ovdje ušao, a ovdje izašao. I on se okrenuo onda, u dvorište se vratio.
The question of impact that these documentaries have is perhaps the most difficult to answer. We have thus far produced five feature length and one short documentary, which have been seen by hundreds of thousands of people. In our line of work, that's a mind-boggling figure, considering that judgments are read by maybe dozens of people and then judgment summaries or court statements are read by maybe a few hundred thousand people. Of course, that does not mean that each and every viewer ends watching these documentaries transformed, denounces denial and relativization of crimes and changes his or her views of the tribunal for the better. But regardless of that, the documentaries achieve their goal. They engage people in the topic which they might rather want to avoid. They are inclined to rethink and reevaluate their positions on the basis of what they see in the film, and they certainly know more about the crimes committed, the tribunal's work, and international justice than they knew before. We are also hopeful, and I'm convinced that these documentaries will be much more used and much more impactful in the future once the tribunal closes down, because the generations born after the conflicts will want to see and learn about the past from these unique products in which the tribunal speaks about the crimes it addressed, but also it speaks about itself and its work. So I would like to end this presentation now at the place where I departed from, in the death camps of Prijedor in Western Bosnia. Our second film, our second documentary, dealt with crimes committed there in Prijedor, in these concentration camps. And we felt very strongly that we want to show them, screen them on those places where the crimes were committed. So in the summer of 2013, we went together with a few dozens of survivors of the camps and peace activists, and we screened the film there. The silence that followed the screening was almost as telling as a very simple sentence uttered by one of the survivors, as he was more than firmly shaking the hand of our producers. And he said, "Thank you for telling my story. And thank you for listening to my story." Thank you.
Thank you, Nanan. Now we'll hear from Keith Hyatt.
Interview. name is Keith Hyatt.
I'm from Berkeley, the University of California at Berkeley, at the Law School, at the Human Rights Center. I am the director of the Human Rights and Technology Program, at the Human Rights Center, which we started not very long ago, last year sometime. So I've been working in that capacity for about a year now. I was a legal aid lawyer before that in East Palo Alto and Silicon Valley for a few years. Before that, I was in law school. Before that, I worked at Microsoft for about 5 years and Boeing for about 3 years before that as a computer programmer and database developer. And my job now is, as a program director at the Human Rights Center, is to try to bridge three communities: lawyers, human rights NGOs, and tech, which is not an easy thing to do, actually, but I'm trying, and we're doing, I think, some really interesting work. One of my roles is to administer the Technology Advisory Board of the Office of the Prosecutor at the International Criminal Court. So some of the things I'm going to talk to you about today will be specific to the International Criminal Court, because that's where my experience is, but there will be implications for other international human rights tribunals. We just heard about one of them, and I'm going to start from judgment as video and go back to video as evidence, right? So sort of a step backwards to talking about the role of video, a particular kind of video, open source video at trial. So the first thing I want to talk about is OSINT, O-S-I-N-T. So we heard yesterday about GEOINT, geospatial intelligence. There are other kinds of intelligence in the intel community, the spy world, like measurement signal intelligence and measurement, and I can't remember the other one. So measurement intelligence is like lasers, like radar. Signal intelligence is like intercepting communications, radio signals, bugging somebody's phone. And then there's OSINT, open source intelligence. This word has been around for a long time. It was very confusing to me initially because I came from the computer programming world, and open source had a specific meaning that I knew what it meant in the world of computer programming. You're talking about a specific kind of methodology and philosophy about developing software where you release the source instead of keeping it secret. Open source intelligence has nothing to do with that. It evolved in a totally different way. That was confusing to me. Maybe it's not confusing to you, but I just wanted to say that up front. We're not talking about open source software or open source code. We're talking about open sources of intel in the intelligence community. So these would be things that were publicly available. So things that spies didn't have to use any covert means to get: phone books, academic treatises, your dissertation thesis. That's all part of OSINT. That's all part of open source intel. Something happened a few years ago that really expanded the world of open source intelligence, though. That was the rise of social media, video sharing websites, the internet in general, being a place for people to collaborate and to share information. Obviously, we know about the implications that has for surveillance and for giving law enforcement and governments greater tools to watch what people are doing. That wasn't really known. It wasn't really thought about early on by the people who were building these tools. It was known by people who care about surveillance, but the people who were building these tools in the first place maybe weren't, this wasn't something they had their eye on early on, and indeed governments didn't have their eye on it early on either. For the most part, it took some time for them to catch up and realize what a profitable source of intel these things could be. But those days are long gone. The government is all over social media. That's not the point of my discussion, though, but I just wanted to set the stage for that, for a discussion of open source intel. Because I want to talk about it in the context of human rights tribunals. So human rights tribunals are not to be outdone by police officers or by the CIA or by the NSA. Human rights tribunals are in this interesting situation where you've got lawyers, ex-police officers, ex-military, who work, ex-human rights advocates who work at a human rights tribunal like the International Criminal Court, and all of them want to do something big to impact human rights, and it's really laudable as a goal. I'm a huge supporter of it. I think it's a great idea. But what happens is that they often want to appropriate the tools, like the best possible tools for law enforcement. What is the NSA using? Let's use that. What is the military using? Let's use that. And one of the things that seems really promising for international human rights tribunals is open source intelligence, using stuff that you can find on social media. I say stuff because it's hard to categorize it in any other way. Videos sometimes photos, sometimes audio clips, sometimes collages, sometimes memes. Like, it's hard. There's a lot of things up on social media that might be relevant or might be useful if you're trying to put together a human rights case. Now, this makes sense for a lot of reasons for international criminal courts or for international human rights tribunals, because A, there's a lot of really rich stuff up there. There's a lot of really rich material, video that you couldn't get in any other way. Maybe there's a video that shows something that happened that there are no longer any surviving witnesses for. There's a lot of evidence that might be really crucial. Not evidence. There's a lot of material that might be crucial as evidence. There's also just a lot of material, like millions and millions of videos. More than any human being or any team at the International Criminal Court is ever going to be able to go through. Millions of videos just from the Syria conflict alone, which is a challenge but also an opportunity that they're excited about. But there are other things going on too. The International Criminal Court, for example, is under massive budgetary pressure. Everybody talks about it being big, bloated, and wasteful. Everybody in the press or sometimes governments will criticize the court. But in reality, I did a little bit of research, and the budget for the Office of the Prosecutor at the International Criminal Court, for example, which houses both prosecutors and investigators, is $18 million less than the budget for last year anyway, is $18 million less than the budget of the Berkeley City Police Force. So Berkeley is the city where I live. There's about 100,000 people there. We have a police force. It's not that big. They do a good job most of the time. They don't have an enormous budget. They don't need an enormous budget. And they have $18 million more than the International Criminal Court. And that's just for the police. The International Criminal Court has investigators plus prosecutors, plus an army of support staff. So their budget is not that big. And they're under a lot of pressure anyway to cut it. The court's IT staff was reduced 20% in the last budget. And every year there's always threats that they're going to get downsized even further. Compare that with the size of their mandate, which is enormous. They're supposed to prosecute all of the world's gravest humanitarian crimes, at least for states that are members of the Rome Statute, but also for any other states where the Security Council of the United Nations refers them. So it's big mandate, big budgetary pressure, which leads them to look for alternative sources of evidence. It's really expensive to send out investigators to interview witnesses. That's expensive. It's also dangerous for the investigators and for the witnesses. So open source intel, OSINT, provides an opportunity for people, for courts who are trying to find a way to reduce their costs, reduce risks to witnesses, and make their presentations more compelling. As a result, a lot of organizations from the NGO community got really excited about how they could help out. So I show here just a couple of examples. There's a million of organizations that wanted to produce apps. The idea was, hey, how can we help? How can we use tech skills to help and do a really great job? So you see, taking a look at the one on the top right, social media is increasingly flooded with material purporting to show human rights abuses, but it's often challenging to prove what's genuine. Now, there's a mobile app to help bring perpetrators of atrocities to justice by verifying footage and ensuring it is admissible in court. That's just one example. There's a million of them. I just took these screenshots off of their websites. But the idea was, hey, how can we take video that's out there and that's being taken by the crowd, right? By all these people with camera phones, and how can we make it admissible in court? So there were a lot of attempts, usually involving somebody putting an app out there. The idea being, other people are going to download this app and use it. So There was a lot of hope at the time in metadata. A lot of people wanted to talk about metadata. I think it, to people who were not technical, it seemed really exciting and very useful, like it was going to be the solution. You see here this quote, "This is a game changer. Unverified data is an enormous problem in human rights and atrocity crime cases." And you see, the idea was if we can just get, look, if video is uploaded to YouTube, for example, all the metadata, all the information like the timestamp, any geotagging that was done on that video, it all gets stripped off. Well, not to Google. Google still has it. But if you're looking at the video on YouTube, you can't really see the metadata in most cases. You can't see the metadata behind the scenes. You don't really know anything about the person that uploaded that video, when they took the video, where they took the video. All you know is what you see. And if you're a human rights tribunal and you download a video from YouTube, that's all you got. You just got the video. So the idea was if we can just get the metadata, then we can authenticate video. To someone who's worked in computers, that's kind of a laughable proposition. Metadata can be forged, it can be fake, it can be wrong. If you record it on a video on a, like, let's say you take a picture with a camera and the clock on your camera is wrong, now you got bad metadata, right? So there's a million reasons why metadata isn't really the answer, but it was a hopeful time. Here's something else hopeful. This is again from one of the websites for one of the apps. What if humans could largely be taken out of the equation? So the idea was, well, there was a really compelling piece of evidence. In this case, they're talking about a really compelling piece of video from Sri Lanka of some soldiers shooting people that were lying on the ground, many of them naked. It's a horrible video. But the idea was, how do you get this into court? If you see the quote I highlighted here, without being able to verify its authenticity, it would have little relevance for a court proceeding. So let's build an app. So for me, I started examining, well, what are the assumptions behind this kind of thinking? Again, I'm trying to bridge the gap between human rights NGOs, tech, and courts. So I'm trying to figure out, what are the assumptions behind this kind of thinking? Why are there so many of these apps? One is that, well, there's this video out there. It's all showing up on social media sites. It might be introduced at trial. Also, it needs to meet high evidentiary standards or else it's worthless. Like we saw, it's a very little value. And that the shooter of the video can and should help with trial prep. That's another assumption. And then that the content of the video is essential at trial. As you know from my abstract, I challenge all of these assumptions and I'm working on a paper to talk more about it. But first of all, the idea that video might be introduced at trial I think is really troubling. Probably not for most of you. You all, I think, are a little more sophisticated than that. You're all thinking about communications. You're thinking about what the role of video and what the role of imagery is in the cause of justice. But for lawyers, like, the only thing we've got is going to trial. So that's the tool in our toolkit as a lawyer. Wow, something horrible happened. Let's sue somebody or let's go to court. That may or may not be the best thing that could happen, but it's an assumption that's there and that's driving a lot of money in human rights organizations and a lot of trial advocacy or a lot of advocacy for civil society is that the best thing to do about this human rights violation is go to trial, and we need this video at the trial. There's also this concept out there, so I'm challenging that first idea. There's also this concept out there that international criminal tribunals have high evidentiary standards, and if you can't meet those high evidentiary standards, it's worthless. Social media, it's never getting into a trial. That's the idea that's out there. I don't think that's true at all. From my examination of the evidentiary standards, for example, at the International Criminal Court, their evidentiary standards are actually extraordinarily flexible. They're so flexible that as an American, I have serious concerns about those evidentiary standards because they're so lax. Anything can get in, almost anything. The only exceptions are certain pieces of evidence that might prejudice the court or that might impugn the morality of a victim of a sexual assault. Those kinds of things usually don't get in. But in any case, the judges are going to see all of the evidence that gets introduced. And then they weigh it. So it really, there's not much of a question about admissibility. The real question is about weighing. How are the judges going to think about this once they take into account? They're going to admit it, but are they going to rely on it? How reliable is it? That's where the real question is for social media video. Is it reliable? Do we even know what we're seeing? That's going to be a really tough challenge to figure out. There's also an assumption that the shooter of a video can and should help with trial prep. This, for me, is really problematic because it puts the person shooting the video and bystanders in the video in a really tough position. If you use that video to go to trial, suddenly you've taken someone who was just a social media contributor and made them a witness in a trial, usually against somebody really, really horrible. These international criminal tribunals do not go after low-level offenders. They always go after high-level offenders, usually people with a lot of money, people with more money in the bank than the International Criminal Tribunal has in its entire budget, people with a lot of resources, and people who do not hesitate to kill witnesses or intimidate them or put them in prison. So you use somebody's video in a trial without making sure you've protected that person, and you could really, really be exposing them to danger. So this assumption, I think, is also problematic. The last thing I wanted to talk about is that the content of the video is essential to trial. There's this idea that if only we had that video from Sri Lanka that I was talking about, if only we had that video, then we could really bring someone to justice. But my contention is that in human rights tribunals at the international level anyway, who you're trying are heads of state and top-level commanders. And it's extremely unlikely that you're ever going to have a video of them pulling the trigger. You're certainly not going to find that on social media. In fact, a smart defendant in an international criminal tribunal will usually stipulate to the fact of the atrocity happening. Yeah, that happened. I wasn't there. Yeah, that happened. But that was renegade soldiers. It wasn't me. Yeah, that happened, but I was a bookkeeper. These are the kinds of arguments that you see in international criminal tribunals, not, no, that never happened. Occasionally that argument is made, but less and less. Now, that's not really so much the problem. So, I think I'll leave it there. I just wanted to point out, thank you, I wanted to point out that these core assumptions that lead to this proliferation of apps, and that if we start to think more about international criminal tribunals in a holistic way, where we're thinking about tech, we're thinking about human rights actors, and we're thinking about law together, then we can maybe make some sense out of what is the role of video at an international human rights tribunal. So far at the International Criminal Court, its social media video has never been used. So we'll see if that changes in the future, but thank you for your time.
Propositions that I want to share with you today, and I'm going to tell you the reasons why I think they're true, but if you during the Q&A can help prove them false, I would love that. So it's kind of a little game that we can play together. So the first proposition is that digital video is a unique form of evidence. Why? It's infinitely replicable, and also people believe that it's self-evident. And neither of those points is new, but I would contend that there aren't many kinds of evidence that fuse both of those factors together. And then I'm going to take that a step further and say, because of those factors, there's a heightened need for transparency in the forensic analysis of those videos. All right, the second proposition.
Thank you. Okay, thank you. The second proposition is that digital video is not unique, that its collection has become identical to any other form of bulk data collection. And therefore, I'll make another argument, the same laws that govern police collection of video, those laws should be the same as the laws that govern police collection of other kinds of data. And the third proposition, which isn't up there, is that these two ideas are inversely related. So that as there will be more and more pressure to authenticate video, either in trial or for public audiences, there will be more and more pressure to pack images with the kind of metadata that I was talking about, whether or not it's actually useful, that will start to be embedded into files. And as computer vision technologies develop as well, the image itself becomes datafied. So as we'll have pressure for the technology to develop in that direction, it will become more and more privacy invasive. It will become less and less like a familiar image and more like bulk data collection. All right, so I'm going to share a couple stories about these propositions to bring them to life. And the first is about the Sri Lanka video that Keith was talking about. So this was a video that came out. It was released by journalists who smuggled it over the border. And there was a dispute about its authenticity. I was actually in Sri Lanka working with filmmakers in Sri Lanka while that dispute was taking place. And what I found surprised me, which was that really smart, thoughtful people believed that this video was fake. And they also had good reasons to think that it was fake. So the Tamil Tigers had a propaganda arm. They had been known to fake videos in the past. They had a whole broadcast network. Why not create a fake video to interfere with post-war reconciliation? So the dispute was between forensic analysts at the UN. When the video came out, the UN, you know, asked the government of Sri Lanka to investigate the incident that was depicted. And the government of Sri Lanka said, how irresponsible, we've just finished a 30-year civil war. We'd like to move forward, gather international aid. You're accusing of this horrific crime, and you haven't even authenticated the evidence before you've done so. So UN hires a forensic analyst to do that work, and the analyst says, okay, the video is likely authentic. And then the Sri Lankan government hired a forensic analyst who said, it's not, it's fake. And so I started to wonder what resources were available to smart people inside the country who had good reasons to mistrust the UN, as well as the video, to make a determination on their own, independently of their identity affiliations with the government. So I paired up with a digital forensic analyst who's here in the US, and together we audited the forensic reports on both sides of the dispute. And what we found surprised me. So this is a page from the Sri Lankan forensic analyst's report. And the highlighted phrase says, the experimental procedures used in this analysis include techniques that have been developed as the outcome of research and development. These techniques or their results may not be deployed by any other organization or individual without appropriate permission. So they're saying the methodology that they're using to analyze this video is proprietary. And you can't use it and you can't replicate it unless you have our permission. For a quick side note, I got very interested in how IP or intellectual property claims might be used to shut off transparency or the reproducibility of forensic analysis. And turns out that this is not a process that's limited to Sri Lankan government or the former government, then there's a new government now, forensic analysts. In fact, it's happening in the US. And so I've also started to write about situations where forensic devices are becoming automated for DNA matching, fingerprint analysis, and those automated devices are being sold by private manufacturers who are claiming trade secrets barriers in the software that's used. The criminal defendants, there's a man in California named Martel Chubbs. He's facing the death penalty. The only evidence against him right now is a match by a proprietary computer program, the only piece of evidence, and courts have denied him access. Okay. This is just an example from the other side. This is the UN forensic analyst. His approach was to use also a proprietary software to run a series of manipulations of the video. And this, what we found here is that that the manipulations that he ran were completely unnecessary to the conclusions that he drew from them. So there's an element of smoke and mirrors in this forensic analysis where I know it's unnecessary because this is the example of what he did. This is the software he used, Cognitech Video Investigator. And what it did, it created it analyzed the velocity of the camera movement between frames. And then it lines each frames into a single image called a mosaic. And here's the image that he used, that he created out of the video. So you see there's multiple frames here. So it's, you know, it's as if they've been all aligned. And the single conclusion that he drew from that manipulation was there's a red stain on the white shirt. Here's a colleague of his who did a similar forensic analysis and came up with a similar conclusion. There's a red stain on the white shirt. You see this image doesn't have any border irregularities. This image was not run through a fancy software program. So to wrap up that story, there's a wonderful philosopher of science named Stephen Shapin, and he argues that the way that modern science gained authority was because, or when, at a tipping point, when scientists started to create more detailed inscriptions of their experiments using detailed notes or charts, drawings, and those inscriptions could circulate to wider audiences than the group of people who would originally be around an experiment performed in demonstration. And that expanded the circle of people who felt that they were a witness to the experiment and could trust its results. I think that because video and digital images as well are infinitely replicable, and because people have an assumption that their meaning is self-evident, audiences, public audiences, are going to be more likely to come to competing interpretations about that kind of evidence than other forms of evidence. And as a result, detailed inscriptions and the transparency of analysis are crucial to create consensus over an image's authenticity, integrity, validity, and meaning. All right, so that's why I think video is different. Here's my argument for why video is the same. So some of you may have followed the debates about body cameras. You know, with the horrific police violence and killings, there's been pressure for law enforcement to wear cameras. Some of the arguments against those have focused on the fact that the cameras point outwards. They don't actually record the officers. And there's been concerns of disproportionate surveillance of minority communities. There have also been concerns that for the first time, those law enforcement cameras are totally mobile and they will enter homes. So the closest analogy we have are dashboard cameras. Those are mobile, but they don't enter homes. Homes are traditionally private spaces that have stronger constitutional protections from law enforcement surveillance. So I started to think, well, what laws should govern what police can record inside of homes? Let's see. That's the same thing that Keith brought up. So this is Informacam, and many of you in the room will be familiar with it. And I just wanted to bring it up here. This is actually the metadata that collects, and I totally take Keith's point that it's not going to help us in court. But the information that's being packed into those files includes GPS coordinates, altitude, compass bearing, light meter readings, the signatures of neighboring devices, cell towers, and Wi-Fi networks. And that's just an example of metadata. Then you have, these are examples from 2012, so they're really old, but they're what was available on YouTube, ways that computers can turn the image itself into data. And so I would think that what an image has become is a collection of sensory information, some related to light, some related to other kinds of input, all wrapped up in a single file with the visualization of a particular part of the light image sensor, of the light sensor data sort of packed on top. And if we think about the image that way, you might consider facial recognition technologies. Those technologies have become so pervasive and advanced that their commercial use has provoked at least one lawsuit for violating biometric privacy. Corporations are seeking and failing to self-regulate. We have real-time event recognition. These are all ways that an image itself, beyond the metadata, but the image can just be turned into information that could be analyzed with locator tags, the same way that we know that the NSA goes through large databases with a verbal tag. Okay. So here's another example, also old, also from 2012, of what computer vision is doing to images themselves. So I started to think about, well, where did the current laws that govern the police collection of this information come from? And I went back into the doctrine, and it turns out that there's two theories about law enforcement or government collection of images. And one is that these images, these are all theories that were developed for analog technologies. These images are mere observation. Okay? Mere observation, the Supreme Court has always said that mere observation doesn't trigger Fourth Amendment protections. Under pre-1967 doctrine, our Fourth Amendment applied to trespass actions. So you can think, well, that makes sense. Light doesn't trespass. And sensor technologies are receptive, so you're always getting the light after it's left somebody's property. So then even if you use illumination or magnification to analyze an image after the fact, maybe see things that you wouldn't have seen in person, you're still not trespassing. Or post-1967, the doctrine changed. Okay. The doctrine changed it to be a reasonable expectation of privacy. And in that, the Supreme Court's actually never addressed what law enforcement images can be taken inside of homes. But lower courts have argued that effectively that police photographs and videos inside homes are comparable observations. And so some quick quotes here. Officers photographed only what was in plain view inside the home. They conducted no search beyond what was visible inside the home. The photographs depicted no more than was in plain view inside the home. And this is why, if police are lawfully inside your home, they can photograph or video at will. I think there's new ways to think about that are coming down the pipeline. The Supreme Court has started to change its analysis of how we should protect information that's already publicly revealed. Some of you may be familiar with these cases, Kylo and Jones, but the idea that collection of information that's different in kind or degree might change the doctrine and implicate the Fourth Amendment. So those are the two propositions, and the idea is digital video is different, and digital video is the same, and that those are inversely related proposals, and I'd love to hear your thoughts about them both.
Thank you, Rebecca, and thank you to all of our panelists. We have some time for questions for the panelists, and if you wouldn't mind, just please identifying yourself when you ask your question. First question in the back, Sharon.
My name is Sharon. I have two questions, actually, for two different sets of panelists. The idea that the last two presentations, something about it like got to me, I suppose because I'm a humanist. So that there's a huge difference, and the idea that visual evidence is reproducible is as old as the hills, and it's not infinitely reproducible, it degrades over time, whether it's digital or not. But there's and that you can go back to the Congo at the turn of the 20th century to talk about the debates about this kind of evidence. But there's a difference, I think, between that, and these, like, when did we forget the rule of the Rodney King video shooting, that evidence is not the same thing as meaning? That whatever the evidence is, that the implication of how that evidence is going to be taken up in terms of its meaning is completely up for grabs. So the kind of, I don't know what happened, but there's like a falling out of the question of meaning in these debates about the technical terms of the evidence. And that's a huge implication. The other question I have is about the former ICTY. And the question of, I mean, you mentioned that the witnesses didn't want to have their testimony. Can you say a little more about that? Because that was a huge debate about the way in which that particular tribunal handled the witnesses, and that there was a subsequent wave of critique, that not unlike what happened at the Eichmann trial with Kay Zednik, and the kind of re-traumatization that witnessing produces. And that so many of the witnesses, and Eric Stover's book about this has been influential, were saying that, you know, that this process of justice completely had nothing to do with what the people that were involved cared about, that they didn't have anything to do with the ICTY, in particular, even the ones that testified, which is why they didn't want their testimony to be circulated, because it didn't take into consideration the human question of what it meant to be a witness.
So thanks for raising those points. The infinitely replicable idea, absolutely, it's been around forever. We have the mechanical reproduction and Walter Benjamin and all of this history. I do think that there's a distinction between analog reproduction and digital reproduction, and you can just ask the IP industries about that. The idea is that while mechanically reproducible in analog form, those reproductions are dependent on a material container to transfer them. And the material container has costs. So whether that's a piece of paper or, you know, a cassette tape, devices to play those, there are some cost limitations on how broadly they expand, and of course the reproduction does degrade more in analog form. So the fact that the movie industry has been gutted by digital technology, I think, is an example of how that does have some effect on meaning. I thought about this yesterday, and I should have said, there is no way that thinking about the image as data or thinking about the data aspect of the image is in any way a replacement of the incredibly important work that theorists are doing, that the talks that we're doing yesterday and this morning about the meaning of the image itself, that is crucial work, and I only intend to supplement it.
I'll say thanks for the shout out to Eric Stover's book. Eric is the faculty director of the Human Rights Center at Berkeley, and his philosophy on these issues informs all the work that we do. This is, I think, you're getting at one of the frustrations that probably came through in my presentation, which is that so much of the debate about video, and especially about social media video, but also about this Sri Lanka video, is about authenticity. Like, the entire debate there, the entire discussion was about whether this video was faked, and not at all about what it would mean if it, like, let's say it wasn't faked, or much discussion about, why don't you just ask the journalists? You know, like, it was all about, no, we need to know if this video is real. Actually, it wasn't even, we need to know if this video is real. It was, this video is real versus this video is not real. And there's a tougher question about what it means for a video to be real or to be authentic. And I also think it's sort of the least interesting question that goes on at trial. One of my arguments is that there is no way to prove that a video is authentic all the way. You have to corroborate it with other kinds of evidence. You have to triangulate by bringing in lots of kinds of evidence to make the case for what you're trying to persuade the judges. And the more we get sidetracked, and that's just to establish that an event happened. It's a much bigger question of what you're trying to do by having a trial at all. I'm a little bit bounded and confined to just talking, assuming that a trial is necessary or that it does something or that it's meaningful. But once you're in a trial, I think what really happens is there may be a big debate about whether a video is authentic or not, but it's not going to, that's not something you're going to be able to resolve with a battle of experts.
I mean, certainly I was trying to talk a lot about the meaning of the images, and, you know, and I do think on some point, you know, is the distinction between authenticity on the one hand and meaning on the other a meaningful distinction? Well, I think probably on some case, yes. But on the other hand, I think one of the other things to pay attention to is that even that distinction becomes volatilized and problematized in a lot of these trials. And that even if you kind of think about, like, the images of Demjanjuk that I was presenting, that I was kind of talking about their meaning, in what sense, you know, they're not exactly, I mean, they are having a patient, so there's a whole notion of doctoring itself is kind of interesting, but they're not doctored exactly in the sense, but on the other hand, they are prepared. So even that kind of distinction between authenticity and meaning very often starts to blur and become volatilized.
Thanks for the question. Well, I, you know, in the course of a criminal trial, there is always a danger of witness being re-traumatized. There are measures and techniques that can be taken to minimize that chance. But you must remember, these people come to the tribunal from their towns or villages in the former Yugoslavia. They might have never left those places. They go to a foreign country, sit before the people they've never seen before, and then they need to speak about the most horrific events that they went through in their lives. So it's an extremely stressful situation. In fact, we were the first tribunal to establish a special victim and witness section, victim and witness unit, and other tribunals have used that as a blueprint for how they approach that. I know that there have been criticisms, but none of those criticisms was based on a full-scale empirical study. One such study is now being conducted by the University of North Texas, and in a few months, the first results will be published. I had an opportunity to see those results, and they are surprisingly positive. Even witnesses for the defense who come to the tribunal with some negative expectations have given extremely positive feedback about how the victim and witness section has treated the witnesses. The reasons we get not allowing us to use some of the testimonies are very different. With some people, it's dissatisfaction with the results of the process. And you must realize that the expectations of people out of the tribunal is to bring complete justice. And that's not what happens in a criminal trial. You go there, and as a witness, you have to answer the questions of the prosecution and of the defense. You're not there to tell oral history and your story the way you want to tell it, which is sometimes what the witnesses want to do, or victims. And the second thing is that they might not be happy with the outcome of the trial if the indicted person is acquitted or the sentence is too lenient in their opinion. But most of the reasons we got is that people just want to put that behind. They came to the tribunal, they testified, they did what they felt was right and what they need to do, and that's it. They don't want to be reminded of it. And that's the reason. But sometimes you're right. Sometimes the people are dissatisfied with the outcome of the trial. But none of the witnesses, I didn't contact them directly. That's done through the victim and witness section. But I was never informed that they have rejected use of their testimony because they were dissatisfied in the way they were treated as witnesses before the tribunal.
I guess I want to push back a little bit on the question of authenticity, because I don't hear, I mean, journalism and human rights documentation has always been about degrees of authenticity. But there's a difference between giving up on authenticity, right, and accepting that you might have a slightly larger degree or a slightly lesser degree. I mean, I guess I want to ask you, if you're not pushing for authenticity, then what are you pushing?
I care a lot about authenticity, but it's always contested in trial, almost always contested in trial, and it's easy to contest it. I think what I'm trying to say is that you're not going to solve authenticity problems with technology. Magic. I think a lot of people thought that apps were going to be this sort of magic beans, that if you planted them in the ground, a beanstalk would grow, and at the top of it would be this magic castle where you had justice. And that's what they're saying, right? This is a game changer. And so my comments are to push back on this sort of utopian view that tech was going to solve authenticity. Tech makes authenticity harder. In a lot of ways, it makes it harder, because tech is the reason you can think that a video might have been digitally altered in the first place. And anyway, there's a lot of ways to fake a video. That some of them involve digital editing. Some of them just involve staging a video. There's no way that I can prove 100% for sure that a video is authentic, just from the video. That's a challenge for social media. Authenticity is always going to be a problem. Reliability is always going to be a problem with stuff you got off social media. That doesn't mean give up on it. That means you have to pioneer new methods of persuading the court, or that what you're looking at means something. You have to use corroboration. You have to use triangulation. You have to tie together the video with other evidence, with verification, like the techniques that are used by, really, that are being pioneered by journalists. I think they're the best at this right now. From courts and from lawyers and from law enforcement, there just has not been serious progress in establishing a methodology for verifying video. We have people in this room who have done serious work on guidelines for verifying video, either at Amnesty or at Storyful. But that's not coming from courts, and it really needs to be. They need to be paying more attention to that. But it will not happen as like a techno solution. It won't happen.
Can I just?
I think there's a difference between, you know, inauthentic in a very kind of what we might describe as transparent sense of, and you know, there's a photograph of bodies, and in fact, these people are not dead. They've just been wearing stained red shirts. But I think the other thing is, you know, what actually, so we can all agree that we should strive for authenticity in trying to exclude those kinds of fabricated images or videos. But on the other hand, if you think back to something like Nuremberg, one of the most famous images that came out of documentary evidence that was submitted there was of small children at Auschwitz revealing their number. You've probably have seen this image. Now, that image actually was not taken at the moment of liberation by the Soviets. The Soviets restaged it to make it look as if they were now just liberating the camp. And so that kind of raises this question, I mean, is that authentic or is that now inauthentic? And this is, again, where the debates then turn into things such as contestations over meaning rather than simple questions about the authenticity of the image.
About the particularity of an image versus the universality of the image. I mean, when we lapse into, excuse me, conversations about meaning, we're going for the latter. But I think that...
The latter being the universality of it?
Yeah.
Well, it doesn't have to be. I mean, the questions of meaning can also be highly, highly particularized.
True. But still, all I'm saying is that, and I think you're right when you say that it's journalists who have really been doing the brave, you know, onward work on this, but it just strikes me that to give up on that as an ideal, however, you know, minimal problematic it is, I think that that's a problem.
Right, but I think the idea is not so much to give up on it, but to be extremely sophisticated in what we mean by it, as if the idea of labeling something as authentic kind of then answers all the questions, when in fact that's when a lot of the questions have to now be asked. I think that's part of what we're...
So. Okay, thank you. We have time for one more question. Yeah?
I mean, maybe it's more a comment. So, I mean, I disagree a little bit that technology cannot help with this. So I think there are technical solutions that will go really, really far. And what I mean with that is that, you know, you can spend days and hours of manually doing the verification work, which
you can... Be a little louder? I can't hear you.
So you can spend days and hours to do the verification work manually, or you have authentic footage, which in my opinion is authentic if you have the proper metadata, and it takes 10 seconds, right? I'm not saying that that will go into court necessarily, but the problem with this discussion is that we always end up, or we start with bringing the material into the courts, and I think that's the problem that you have identified with these apps. They only talk about using this in courts, which I personally might not care about, but what the videos and the images will do, they will create the trial in the first place, because that's setting up a trial is in many cases a political decision, right? So as an advocacy group using this sort of materials, it's very, very helpful to have. If it's not accepted in court, it's fine. There's enough other, I think, evidence normally available, and I think nobody would ever make a claim to like have any sort of trial or even an Amnesty research report on one single video, right? And I think that's exactly also the point you're making. One video is just not enough. We always have corroborative information. And I think Sri Lanka is a perfect example. if the video, you know, whatever is happening is the video, there's enough other information that we can use. But the video itself, I think, created so much pressure, and I disagree that the discussion was only on authenticity. It created a lot of pressure, especially in DC. And it was very interesting to see, to have Sri Lankan government officials come to the various events on Capitol Hill and in private institutions embarrassing themselves, defending their position, because it was just not credible, I think. So I think there's a lot of like powerful sort of like things we can do with this sort of content, even if it might not end up in court, which I know, I think people mostly agree with that. I think it's sometimes difficult to start discussing using this in court in the first place.
Yeah, I actually totally agree with everything you said. I think technology can help. I mean, I run a program called Human Rights and Technology. I care a lot about technology. It will never solve the problem. It's not the answer, but it can definitely help. And I also totally agree. Part of the problem is when we start thinking about court, or when we start from the beginning thinking about how is this going to matter in court. That's what I'm trying to push back on. I think that's the least, like that's the rarest situation imaginable is where you're actually going to court. So building something from the beginning, an app, for the purpose of going to court, is weird, because how do you even get the app to people that are gonna film this stuff in the first place? What courts have to grapple with is what they actually have, and what they actually have is a lot of videos that are up on social media websites with no metadata or with very limited metadata, and that is a really hard problem, and tech isn't just going to solve that magically for them.
Any other final comments by the panelists?
May I just say I have a few copies of our latest documentaries, so if anyone is interested, just please let me know and I can give it to you.
Okay, thank you again for everybody for being here, and thank you again to our panelists.